right. Well, welcome to this second installment of the Speaker's Lecture Series. I'm Steve Boylard. I'm the Executive Director at the Center for California Studies here at Sacramento State. And I'm happy to see such a good turnout from the campus and broader community today. Just last week, we had a full-day conference downtown on civic engagement. And this, I think, is a good example of what that looks like when people are engaging with other government around policy issues. So again, thank you so much for showing up today. Today's event is part of a series of discussions that are around the state between the leader of the State Assembly, Speaker Anthony Rendon, and different campus communities. And these, the speaker is able to engage in dialogue with our academic communities around issues of the day. This idea for the speaker series is actually borrowed from Great Britain, as are so many things these days, like the office or other things we borrow from them. We've borrowed this idea of a speaker series where the Parliament of Britain began a series of lectures, speaker's lectures, starting in 2011, which was the 100th anniversary of the Parliament Act. And those speaker's lectures are designed to encourage engagement between the public and the work of the Parliament. So in a similar way, in a parallel way, we have sought to create this series that will engage the institution of the California Legislature with our academic communities around the state. The series was developed as a collaboration between the Center for California Studies at Sacramento State and Speaker Anthony Rendon's office. We at the center see this as a real ideal opportunity to promote the center's mission, which is to bridge academia and government in the service of strengthening California's democracy. The inaugural lecture of this series was held last month down at the Pat Brown Institute at Cal State Los Angeles. And we anticipate there'll be additional installments of this series at different campuses around the state as we move forward. This event is the result of a lot of good work by a lot of dedicated individuals. I'd especially like to thank the speaker's staff, and in particular, Anthony Liao, who has worked directly for several months on this program. He actually happens to be an alum of our Assembly Fellows Program, and I take the opportunity just to remind you that applications for our Capital Fellows Programs are now open for all four of our Capital Fellows Program. That's an online application, and we have brochures back there at the front table. I'd also like to thank my colleagues at the Center for California Studies, particularly Pam Chu, who is the director of the Assembly Fellows Program, and Rotzi Hernandez, who's been working closely with Pam behind the scenes for the past several months. We also appreciate the support of President Nelson and the public affairs team here at Sacramento State, including Vice President Phil Garcia and the Director of Federal and State Relations, Nathan Dietrich. I also want to thank our Dean, Ern Bedvarsson, and Government Department Chair Nancy Lapp for doing so much to promote the program here on campus. It's been a tremendous help. I want to also acknowledge several other campus leaders who have been able to join us here today. Dr. Amy Kautzman, who's the Dean of the University Library. Dr. Lorenzo Smith, who's the Dean of Engineering and Computer Science. And Dr. Steve Perez, who's our Vice Provost. Finally, I'd like to acknowledge the many legislative staff who've been here representing their offices today. And we truly appreciate your support. And I want to make a special welcome to former Assembly Member Sunny Mojene, who we at the Center have been working with closely on her Women in California Politics project, so we appreciate your being here today. Finally, please note this program is being live streamed, and that means, number one, that your friends can see what you're experiencing here, and number two, that it would really be great if you'd silence your phones. You can, of course, still use your phones to tweet about the event, and we have Twitter handles and other information at the bottom of your programs. So with that, I'd now like to introduce our president, Dr. Robert Nelson, who became Sacramento State's 8th permanent president just a little over a year ago. He's not your typical university president. He grew up on a cattle ranch in Montana. He was the first in his family to get a college degree, and he got his bachelor's and master's degrees, both from Brigham Young University, and that's where he met his wife, Jody Hawkins. Shortly after earning his doctorate at the University of Chicago in 1989, President Nelson became vice provost at the University of Texas, Dallas. He also served as vice president for business affairs at Texas A&M at Corpus Christi, and then became president of the University of Texas Pan American. He's now here with us, leading us at Sacramento State, and he's already made, I think, a huge impact on this campus. He's focused very strongly on student success. He's got a commitment to getting our students through this institution with lower debt and equipped with skills for productive careers. And I really think this is a man who truly believes in the great noble mission of the university, which is to help people fulfill their full potential, to encourage self-exploration, and ultimately to produce graduates that serve the community and serve the broader society by providing the kinds of skills that come from productive, engaged individuals who are lifelong learners. So that's a pretty high bar, but I think that we at Sacramento State, under President Nelson's leadership, are doing a pretty good job of delivering on that. So I'd like you to please welcome President Robert Nelson.
You got to talk to him. I'm supposed to do Phil Donahue. How many of you even remember who Phil Donahue is? Not most of the students, I can guarantee you. Thank you, Steve, for the introduction. And yes, it is all about the students, and that's what I like the most today as I look out here, seeing the students here. Yes, faculty, I love you. But seeing the students here and having this opportunity, I've got to thank the speaker for having this series, bringing it to universities, offering our students the opportunity to look into government and to understand what is actually happening, and to see and feel the importance of it, and maybe to dream a little bit about being you or you. That's the possibilities, and that we need that leadership here. We are California's capital university. I'm very proud of it. We're just a little ways from the capital itself. We're putting a downtown center so that we can have more and more involvement with the capital. And we have great students who are working there. I remember the first day I went, the very first day I had the job here, I went down there, and everybody was coming out of the offices saying, "Stinger's up," you know, because they all work here and graduated here. And I like to think that we're producing great representatives down there. So it's really an honor with our Jesse Unruh's Assembly Fellows Program, with everything else we're doing, to be able to continue that partnership. So it is my honor to introduce Speaker Rendon. He became the speaker he is the 70th speaker. Boy, that's a lot longer than eight presidents, okay? 70th speaker of the California State Assembly in March 2016. He was first elected to represent the 63rd Assembly District of the South East Los Angeles County in 2012. And what I like even more is that before that, he was very involved in nonprofit childhood education efforts. He has been a true champion of education in all of his elements and everything he's done. And he has his degrees from CSU Fullerton, his master's and his undergraduate, and he served there as an adjunct professor. So welcome. He also, by the way, gave me permission to do Stingers Up, and he referred to me when we met. "Oh, you're the guy who screams." Yeah. Assemblyman Kim Cooley has his district less than a mile from here, and I met him on the very first day that I was here as well, and he took me down onto the floor, and we had pictures taken. We had a great time getting to know him. He has been in politics since 1977, when he was a key staffer for then Assembly Rules Committee Chairman Lou Pappin. He has served in Rancho Cordova's first city council when the city was first formed, and he's been involved now in the Senate since 2000, 12. So we're very grateful to have him here and to have him representing Sacramento and our group. And finally, our moderator today, John Myers, is here. I think a lot of us read his blog, or his he's got a politics blog, one of the first ones that was been around here, and now he's even got kept up and is doing politics podcasts, and he's very, very informed on what's happening. I think he'll be an excellent moderator for us today. So with that, I'm going to invite them all up, but students, join me with the California Assembly and Sac State, our number one, stingers up, okay? And let's show them how it's done. Okay, you ready? Come on, students. The California Assembly and Sac State, our number one, stingers up! If I could invite the three panelists to the podium.
Now I'm not. Whoa, holy mackerel. This has been a week of hot mics in politics, so we're not going to... Come on.
Wow.
I'm a reporter. What do you expect? Yeah, a little hot. Thank you very much for having me. I appreciate it. It's interesting in sitting here talking about this. So my job as a reporter at the Capitol, which has been for quite a while, and I'm now the bureau chief of the Los Angeles Times, and I get to talk to these guys, but I don't ever get to talk to them kind of like when you step back and think about the bigger picture of the legislature and the legislative process. And so I think this is going to be an interesting conversation, obviously with two men who know a lot about it, with Mr. Cooley, who's been there for a very long time, and Mr. Rendon, who, of course, is new to the institution, but has heavy as the head that wears the crown as the Speaker of the Assembly. So we're going to talk a little bit about the past and present and the future of the legislature, and then we've got an opportunity for all of you to ask your own questions, and should be a good conversation. Let me start rolling back the clock a little bit. We know, and Mr. Cooley can talk about it in a moment, that the California legislature has been a full-time legislature for the last 50 years. It was 1966 when the voters decided that they wanted to go from a part-time legislature to a full-time legislature. In your preparation to take over as the leadership of the House, I know you talked to former speakers, and from Willie Brown to others, but certainly Willie Brown was the speaker, some of you will know, for quite some time, the longest-serving speaker in modern times. What did they tell you about the nature of the institution in the quote-unquote old days, good or bad, as things for you to know when you took over?
Sure, acknowledging that this is a different time. The vast majority of the speakers who are still around served in post-term limited era. They did acknowledge that this was a different time, and for the most part, they didn't serve in the same sort of houses as will exist.
The what I was gonna ask you though, Mr. Cooley, was, you talk about the oversight, and the oversight responsibility of the legislative branch, and you're pointing out the stats about one house versus the other. Why did the oversight capacity seem to diminish? I mean, what's the root of why that power of oversight of the legislative branch, at least in the assembly side, I guess to your point, seemed to evaporate in some ways?
Well, I think for members who come to Sacramento newly elected, they're immediately managing bills, introducing bills, attending hearings, passing bills. The members don't have the time to delve into the subject matter as extensively as committee chairs. And that's where you drive the oversight agenda. So I think members of longer term will be more inclined to do oversight. It's also an aspect of understanding the size of the office. When you've been a member in the old days, 10, 15, 20 years, the scope of this office under the Constitution is very profound. And members sort of find a collegiality in how big this office is. And they reinforce grappling with the future of the state, looking at how they can personally impact it. The size of the office that Mr. Speaker and I fill, our Senate colleagues, is honestly, I would say, bigger than that of a member of Congress, because the federal government's more limited.
Just a curious show of hands in the audience. In theory, and this is a great thing for political science and students in here in government, in theory, how many of you think that term limits are a good idea? Okay, so three. No, I'm kidding. But how many of you worry about term limits in theory? That's interesting. Now, that to me, and people who are watching a live stream, most people raise their hand. They said term limits they think are a problem in theory. But that is somewhat counter to the normal narrative in the public, where you look at polling. Polling shows that term limits are popular. How you get them right. And I'm just curious, now serving an elective office, what do you think about the concept of term limits? Do you see a value in it? Do you worry about it? I mean, and we can talk about the term limits that we're under now, but do you see what I'm saying? I mean, do you feel as though these folks in the audience, or you come across with the people in the polls who say, yeah, I kind of like the idea of a term limit?
I'm just happy I can breathe again. I was worried about the microphone in my... well, you're right. Most people raise their hands saying they are worried about term limits, but it was pretty close. I thought it was close enough. And I think that sort of mixed reaction is the same sort of reaction that I have. I think it's quite obvious with respect to issues of diversity, the size of the Latino caucus, the size of the Asian Pacific Islander caucus, grew during the era of term limits, and there was greater representation of greater diversity of various groups within the era of term limits. That certainly helped with respect to that dynamic.
And if I can say, simply because you didn't have incumbents in offices, and the demographic changes of California allowed some more diversity.
Absolutely.
In the House.
Absolutely, and to an extent also, and there's some political science literature on this too. The demise of term limits, the institution of term limits also led to sort of a crumbling of various sort of political dynasties that existed in California, political machines that existed in California. At the same time, and this is an analogy that I used yesterday to a group of optometrists, I said, you would not want to be told you could only be an optometrist for 6 years and then you have to go on to become a mechanic. You would not want to be a heart surgeon for only 8 years and then told you have to go on and do some other profession. There's a tremendous amount of institutional knowledge, a tremendous amount of policy knowledge, a tremendous amount of the knowledge of the levers of sort of moving government that you can learn. I would be on the ballot for the last time as a member of the state legislature, really starting to feel like I'm learning my job at this point. So I think that
your predecessors were the last few.
Absolutely, yeah, they would have been done at this point. And there's also, and again, I think this touches on something that we were talking about earlier. I managed a political campaign in 2006. The gentleman whose campaign I managed served in Sacramento for 6 years. He chaired business and professions for two, banking for two, transportation for two. It's impossible to gain any depth of policy knowledge in such short stints. So from that perspective, I thought it was definitely problematic.
Mr. Cooley, could you talk a minute about, before we move into kind of where we are in the legislative universe now, but how in that term limit area, I guess term limit era in particular, the balance of power between the legislative branch and the executive branch shifted in some ways? I mean, did you have governors who had a little more power, even not so much in the number of years they had, but because governors already, I mean, the executive branch already has a fair number of levers that it can pull. I like watching that every year when you all negotiate with the executive branch. But they have a lot of levers they can pull about things. If you look even, as we've talked about the lack of legislative veto overrides, I mean, we haven't had one in the state since 1979?
79.
So no governor, you think about that, no governor who's rejected a bill has had the legislature say, eh, in, you know, almost 40 years.
Right. Yeah, I think the job of the legislature, it is to pass laws, but it's also to keep an eye on how the current laws get implemented. This doesn't always mean you're having a dispute with the governor who's implementing it, even if they may be of a different party. It also means, are the current laws the right ones for our contemporary needs? Because the laws are on the books, and they're on the books forever. And the executive branch will implement them forever unless we go back and say, you know, I think the priorities have changed. So in the old days, a legislature engaged with oversight, following what the implementation is of the laws, was keeping a closer eye on things. And they dropped dramatically. Term limits were adopted in 1990, kicked in fully in 93, or in 96. By then, all the old-time members were gone, and now you had these short-term members. And the level of published activity of oversight dropped dramatically, as I said a few minutes ago. It's interesting because there were other changes that were at work in the legislature that didn't actually take a toll on the oversight, because when Prop 13 passed in 78, we had 16 new members, so-called Prop 13 babies, Republicans that came in. It was a huge crowd of very conservative members. Within 2 years, they'd overturned the Republican leadership. And so the institution took a sharp turn to the right, which created some tension in the body, but oversight remained robust. So those members still had this understanding that our job is to go to bat for the public and keep an eye on what the executive branch is doing, whether it's Jerry Brown, George Duke Majan, Pete Wilson, Gray Davis, Arnold Schwarzenegger. So I definitely think that the imposition of term limits just mowed down this attention to what the executive branch is doing, empowering all the agency folks who felt they could outlast the legislature. They'd come in, you'd ask some pointed questions. I've watched this happen in hearings. You have a question with what they're doing, you ask a very pointed questions, they say they'll get back to you, and they sort of assume that the members' focus will shift.
And isn't that true as well, before we move on to another topic, about the concerns about power vested inside the third house, the lobbyists, and power invested in staffers in the legislature, where the staffer knows the policy issue better than the member, because the staffer's been here 20 years, the member's been here 4.5 or something to that effect.
Right. Yes, that also...
Says the former staffer.
Yeah, says the former staffer. Yeah, the staffers were very empowered, and they could have trouble getting their member to kind of grasp what they see as the significance of the issue. We have Peter Detweiler here, longtime consultant in the Senate Local Government Committee, who is an expert's expert in his field, and led the way in a lot of oversight in the Senate, a process that I participated in local government. But the members were much weakened vis-a-vis the lobbyists, also their staff.
So let's talk about the current era a little bit, but let me start it in a maybe somewhat of an unusual way. One of your jobs, Speaker Rendon, is to elect Democrats as the leader of the Democratic caucus. You're the leader of the larger House, but of course you have a party affiliation. And you go, and others too, but I mean, I know part of your job is you have to recruit people to run for office. Sometimes, and you yourself, you know, probably somebody came down and put their arm over your shoulder and said, "Have you thought about running for the assembly?" Is that hard to do? Is it hard to get people to want to get into this? I mean, you know, we talk about the different colliding of the worlds. There's the larger, you know, I'm representing Californians. I'm doing important things about policies that matter for the state. There's the raw politics of running for office, campaigns, and the chaos that can ensue, which is kind of my favorite part as the reporter. But I mean, is it hard to get people to run ever? Do they doubt it? The effect on their family, the effect on being able to be effective, you know, and making a difference? Or what do you tell them more than is it hard? What do you say to them?
Well, first of all, it's not necessarily hard to get people to run for office. It's hard to get the right people to run for office. Sometimes people will say, "Oh, I want to run for office," and you think, "Wow, really?" I also think there's this other dynamic, which is that I think I was a terrible candidate. I've become a decent enough member, But the skill set that you need to be a candidate is very different from the skill set that you need to be a member of the legislature. So that disconnect is very difficult. And I think that's usually what I emphasize to them. There are sometimes potential candidates who I think, wow, that would be a fantastic candidate, not necessarily a good member. Sometimes they think that would be a great member. How do we get that person through the campaign? And occasionally you meet someone who's both. And if you have a pretty good mix, then I think you sort of encourage them to take a shot at it. I think we have enough diversity of backgrounds in our house right now. You have obviously former staff members, you have attorneys, you have members of the military, teachers, nonprofit folks. We have enough different folks in our house, as certainly in our caucus, so that I can tell potential candidates, I can point to them and say, look, this person's made it work. If you have a family, I say this person has made it work. But you do have to impress upon them how incredibly difficult it is. My wife and I don't have kids. She's from Sacramento. That makes it a heck of a lot easier. But the toll that it takes on members, on family, is quite profound.
And then once they get to Sacramento, and you talk to them about their role, their responsibility, how you communicate with them. How many of you in the audience here in the room watch House of Cards? Oh yeah, come on, sure you do. And so there was this great line in the first season that apparently the actor who plays the president, spoiler, but was a member of Congress, Kevin Spacey, the actor Kevin Spacey, says he got from Kevin McCarthy, who we remember was the leader of Republicans in the Assembly back in the mid-90s, and now is the House Majority Leader in Washington. And apparently it's McCarthy's line, but it was, you know, vote your district, vote your conscience, do whatever you want to do, just don't surprise me. Ever been a conversation similar to that?
Well, first of all, Kevin McCarthy told me that Kevin Spacey took that line from Kevin McCarthy. probably true.
It's a good story, but go ahead.
That's really a question of democratic theory. It really is. And
what do you believe in that, if I may say?
With respect to, do you vote your district or you vote your conscience?
How do you navigate it?
I do. I think every member has to do it on an individual basis. I don't think that members of my district voted for me to sort of serve as a computer where the sort of the data comes in and then it comes out. I think they want me to sort of be endowed with a certain level of creativity and a certain level of engagement with my members, and the product of whatever comes to me should at times be modified, at times be reflective of something that the vast majority of folks in my district sometimes are in favor of, and sometimes, I have voted for positions that, quite honestly, I think, you know, folks in my, I have a district that's exceptionally Latino, overwhelmingly Catholic. My positions on gay rights are significantly different than a lot of folks in my district. 2/3 of the folks in my district voted yes on Proposition 8. I'm not there. That's not something I'm ever going to do. They have an opportunity every 2 years to challenge my views on different issues and the work performance that I've done. But as far as I'm concerned, I conduct a job interview every 2 years, and if they want to send me back, great. If not, it's my job in the meantime to vote my conscience.
Assemblyman Cooley, what's your thought on that? The quintessential, you know, how you view representation?
Well, I would say I try to be thoughtful. To me, one of the great challenges in our era is trying to bring along all Californians with our legislative process, our governmental process. We have plenty of people who feel disengaged. I think you look at the presidential race. One of the most shocking things about the presidential race, apart from the rhetoric, is the evidence that there's a large number of Americans who do not feel a connection to this power structure that is out there. We hear that a little bit in the Jefferson conversation. Folks in the, you know, the counties of Jefferson.
State who, of
know,
Jefferson up north. State the of Jefferson up north. Nature, yeah.
So I sort of feel that our challenge is to do our job, to work on the future of the state of California, to bring forward responsible choices of the future, but to try to do it in a way that we bring along all Californians with us to the extent we can. Mr. Speaker has been very instrumental already in the time he's been there, modeling, going out all around California to engage in a public policy conversation. He's done it formally with hearings. He's done it collegially with members on both sides of the aisle, bringing sort of a human touch, a sense of community whole conversation to Sacramento. And I actually feel that is a vital conversation to extend out over the course of the next 8 years of his speakership. I think this is an opportunity for us to try to reconnect Californians with a more engaged legislature. And that is a backdrop to me on a lot of issues. It's like, am I going to spike any sentiment that maybe I'm a representative and trying to listen? Or am I going to just have people throw up their hands and say, well, he's more of the same? I mean, I think it's our opportunity to kind of change the nature of the civic dialogue, and this lecture is vital to that.
So let me shift us to talking about some of the quote-unquote reforms that came down the pike over the course of the last 8 years. Because if you step back and think, and I think what's interesting about this conversation is we are taking a bit of the long view, starting in an era where there weren't term limits, and then into term limits, and then into these new eras. But if you look at a lot of that, I mean, we had a lot of change in just 8 years' time. Three things in particular. We had the way political maps were drawn changed. The voters decided that no longer these gentlemen and others in the Capitol would draw political maps once a decade redistricting process, but we would give it to a citizens commission that would draw it without looking at party affiliation. Then we had the change in the primary system, the top two primary, where only the top two vote getters, regardless of party, move on to November, in which case we've had a lot of same party battles in November as a result of that over the last few election cycles. And then we had the change in term limits, which we've kind of hinted about here for a little bit in 2012, which now allows a member to serve up to 12 years in one house, assuming that you get reelected. I always say that when somebody says, I've got 12 years, I say, you've got 12 years if the voters give you 12 years. You've got to go run for... Yes, yes. So those are three pretty consequential changes just in the course of like 4 years, 2008, 2010, 2012, when the voters did all that. Mr. Cooley, maybe I'll start with you. What do you see that change look like in the context of the larger history of the legislature? That's a lot of change.
It is a lot of change. I think the theory is that the top two primary people have to run to the middle because you're going to try to appeal to all the voters in your district across a broad spectrum, so maybe somewhat less polarizing. I think, to me, the most consequential change is that 12-year change, because members have the chance to grow up into this career, to start to understand this office together. When our class was formed, I felt a little uneasy with the idea of just trying periodically to get the whole class together, Democrats and Republicans, not simply a partisan thing. But we've done that in our class several times a year. The whole class, we do things on a joint basis, the simple object of which was to grow collegiality. And I personally think that if we can take the class of 2012 and our successors and have people over the course of 12 years realize how huge this office is under the state constitution, so that we sort of form a collegiality that no 80 people can touch the future the way we can, the way Mr. Daley can up in Northeast California, whom Anthony's been his home twice. When people start to realize that this office is so big and the 80 of us can sort of shake hands and change the future, that will be powerful.
Now, I'm going to poke a hole in that just a little bit, which is, I understand collegiality, everybody's together, we've got more time to form bonds. You're still fighting over issues. You still don't have Republicans who are going to vote for a tax increase. You didn't have Republicans vote for a lot of the climate change issues. It took a very long, by my read, sorry, it's the reporter's prerogative, took a long time and a lot of arm twisting to get the funding for health care through a health care tax in the early part of 2016. It is not as though everybody is just like, you know, arms around
kumbaya.
Each other. It's not brothers in arms. Hey, we got everything solved. It is still intense disagreements, often along party lines, but as we have seen with the new nature of the Democratic caucus, sometimes inside your caucus. But I guess my point is, longer term limits isn't necessarily the solution to partisanship or to big fights. And both of you can weigh in, but go ahead.
Yeah, you're right. But I mean, we didn't get a lot of Republican votes on climate change. We didn't get a lot of Republican votes on a number of issues, items this year. That being said, we got a lot of Republicans on the MCO tax. We got a lot of Republicans on the water bond a couple of years ago. The collegiality that Mr. Cooley talks about is real. That being said, you're right. Partisanship hasn't disappeared, and it shouldn't. There are real ideological differences between the parties, and that should be reflected in the way we vote. If it's not, then we're not, I think we're not adhering to our own political ideologies. That being said, we've talked a lot today about oversight. That's something that we could all work on together. It's something we do work on together to a large extent. I just came back a couple of weeks ago from a lobbying trip to Washington, D.C. I went with Minority Leader Chad Mays. Chad and I talk a couple times a week. That relationship between he and I is something that I think is exceptionally beneficial for our house. And I know that, you know, Ken mentioned Brian Dolly, Brian Mainsheim. I have a number of friends on the other side of the aisle. Even those who ideologically are distant from me, a Shannon Grove, for example, who comes from probably the most conservative district in the state.
Bakersfield.
She understands early childhood education like very few people do. So like any other work environment, we disagree on a whole heck of a lot of stuff, but we find common ground on other things as well.
How do you see, because one of the effects, all of the changes that I laid out from redistricting top two term limits, especially in the top two where you can have an intra-party do-over or rematch in November, and that typically is more Democrats, probably because there are more Democrats than Republicans in California. But the top two system and the longer term limits, one dynamic that certainly we talk a lot about in the press, because we've watched it in watching all of you serve, is how heterogeneous Democrats are, especially in your house. Mr. Cooley, you're often identified as someone in the quote-unquote mod caucus universe. I'm not sure that I use the term mod because I'm not really sure what the other side of that spectrum is. But they are often different on economic issues than other Democrats. Talk a little bit about how that has changed. It has changed the dynamic of what it means to be a Democrat. Certainly doesn't mean that there's a lot of daylight between the two of you on a lot of core Democratic issues. But you may have disagreements on other things that I don't know whether you would say help the process, complicate the process. I don't want to judge it. But what do we make of that change where the Democratic Party inside the legislature has become more diverse than ever, not by race and gender, but by economics, perhaps?
Sure. Well, there's a few things. First of all, if Chad Mays were here, he would tell you, wow, I have a lot of factions in my party, too. There's more of us. We consider ourselves a big tent party. So I think it's natural that there would be various factions within our party. That being said, I mean, if you look at literature on from political science and voter behavior, their moderate Dems exist in the legislature, but they certainly exist in American society at large too. The extent to which the behavior of voters and the ideology of voters is complicated and vast is, I mean, I'm thinking about E.J. Dionne's Why Americans Hate Politics, which was, I think, in the early 90s, and he said that Americans tend to agree with the economic positions of Republicans for the most part and disagree with the Republicans on social issues. I think there's a lot of folks in California who feel the same way. And the reverse is true as well with respect to social and economic issues as well. So I don't think it's all that different, and I certainly don't think, I mean, if you think about U.S. politics in the 1960s, I mean, think about the Democratic Party and the vast differences that existed that really held up civil rights legislation. It was folks from the Democratic Party in the South who held up those policies. If you think of the 1964 election, if you think of Barry Goldwater, for example, the vast differences within the Republican Party at that time, even the Democratic convention that exploded in Chicago in 1968, that was because of two different factions of the Democratic Party. So I guess my point is I'm not sure that it's all that we're at a period in our history that's all that unique.
Yeah. And I would jump in on that. You go back to 1978 when the legislature was trying to put its alternative to Prop 13 on the ballot. Six times the Senate sent bills over to the Assembly and they died because of fights within the Democrats about strategy. So we've always had factions. I think on this issue of collegiality and where does that go, I agree you still have it. But we were all moved at the end of session to hear very conservative Brian Jones on our outgoing rules chair, Rich Gordon, tremendous rules chair, great colleague. The colleague that I most look to learn how to be a lawmaker was Rich Gordon, so I will really miss him as he gets termed out this cycle. But Brian Jones saying, if I had six more years, I'd give it to you, Rich Gordon. Rich Gordon, who's a very different member than Brian Jones. But on this issue, I think another change by the voters, which I think enters into the climate in the building, is they passed the provision allowing simple majority budgets.
I should have added that one.
So you don't actually, it used to be you needed a two-thirds vote to pass the budget. So on top of all the other elements that make for friction in the legislature's work, we would have these train wrecks every summer over the budget and the fight to get two-thirds and the leverage it created and the heat and bitterness and antagonism that arose from that. So that's now off the table. So you have longer-term members able to sink their teeth into policy. You have factions on both sides of the aisle on the Republican side so that there's more middle-of-the-road folks. Some folks haven't taken the anti-tax pledge, for example, which has been a factor for a long time. So there are some dynamics which are a little more wholesome, and we have at least time to become friends. You know, the Senate Democrats, for heaven's sake, meet in the Ken Matty Lounge. Ken Matty Lounge, an esteemed Republican.
But what do we make, just quickly, and I think those are important points, and I should have mentioned that, Prop 25 in 2010, which made a simple majority to pass the budget, which means Democrats have passed budgets without Republican votes. Good or bad in partisan politics, but certainly we're not camped out all summer waiting for a budget. All of my early years as a reporter was missing every 4th of July party, every other thing, because I was in the hallway waiting for white smoke on a budget. But one of the things, and we waited and waited. But one of the things that I was just going to point out about this new era, and you talk about, you know, all these upsides, and I think those are all valid points. The campaign world and the influence and the interest group world is recalibrated itself to this dynamic about top two and longer term limits. And one of the things that we are in a campaign season, sitting here talking, we are, you know, less than 5 weeks out from an election. And I look at the money being spent in legislative races. And let me pause here to say, not the money that necessarily Ken Cooley and his assembly candidate committee is running, but in these independent expenditure committees, these interest groups that can't coordinate with the committees. We're somewhere around the $15, $16, $17 million mark for the general election cycle. We had another 10 to 12 in the primary cycle. We're getting close to the $30 million mark to influence a handful of legislative races. You're all nodding because you see these numbers and you either like them or are sweating them out when you see them every time for the races you're watching. But I mean, that's a direct, that to me is worth noting. I mean, that is an interest group universe that is trying to, I think, as I said, calibrate itself toward the new reality, figure out where its allies are, figure out how it wants to influence policy. And that is out there. You're not immune to that as a member. Not saying that there's anything you can do about it, but you know when someone drops a big IE, quote unquote, on your head one day, and like what that does. And it's a different dynamic that you have to serve under, I guess, is my larger point. It's just it's a reality of the new system and the quote unquote reforms that you've got interest groups that are playing the political game differently.
Well, I would say if this is true, there is this element of money, but I would, anyone out there that if you are interested in government and you are interested in touching the future, you should think about getting involved locally and look to run for office. And if you want to do that, I will tell you how to do that. You just got to jump in, you start growing your voice, you start growing your recognition, you get seen as a problem solver, and ultimately all of this money will start to pivot to people who have distinguished themselves in their community. So I certainly see it, but I just think, you know, democracy is the worst form of government except for all the others. And you can have an impact, as astonishing as it seems, if you just set your sight on the future of your state and your community, your local school district. We had all kinds of school districts in my district. People filed and ended up getting appointed because no one even ran. You know, there are opportunities to run for office and grow your name. And if you distinguish yourself, the world will start to turn in your direction.
I recognize the irony of saying money is a problem, given that it's my job to raise a lot of money, and I've had a pretty good year too.
wait a second. Wait, let me get my pen out. Sorry, it's the reporter part. Go ahead.
Money is a problem in politics. It really is. It's a profound problem. That being said, what Ken just said rings true. Even from a more cynical perspective, I mean, if there's anything that I've learned in Sacramento with respect to the third house, and you asked earlier about candidates, it's that third house loves a winner. They don't want to back someone who's going to lose. The third house, no matter what political stripe or ideology they happen to be wearing, they never say, oh, that candidate right there is bound to lose. I think I'll go write a big check. They tend to support people that they think are going to win. If you're effective in your local community as a school board member, as a council member, as Ken was, we're joined by our colleague Kevin McCarty, who is a very, very effective local council member here in the city. If you're successful, you will be that person who will be favored by the third house. So money is a problem, but to Ken's point, if the way to sort of co-opt the system is to be a heck of a good candidate.
So let me ask about a couple of other things here, and reminder that in a little while we're going to come to your questions, so be thinking them. There'll be a microphone in the back that'll run around for you. So I want to talk about one thing that the voters are going to consider on November 8th that gets to the legislative process, Proposition 54. It's a ballot measure. All of you know this, right? You've memorized all 17 ballot measures, right? Good. No, you haven't, in which case you can read latimes.com, and it's the plug. We'll give you the rest of the information. But Prop 54, which is on the ballot, which was placed on the ballot by initiative, and I'll talk about that process in a moment, but Prop 54, in one of its parts, and probably the part that it's being talked about the most, is it would require what I'm almost calling a cooling off period, a 3-day period by which most pieces of legislation would have to be available for public review before the two of you could give them a final vote. And clearly inspired by what some would argue is the downside of the legislative process and trying to make a deal and trying to find the right key moment in different constituencies for the language of complicated policy, which is bills that happen late, bills that are drafted and on the floor in a matter of hours. And so Prop 54 is supposedly, its proponents would say, is an antidote to that. You can talk about pro and con Prop 54, but can you talk about at least what the concern is? I mean, we can get to the campaign, but you understand the concern that policymaking is happening without public review.
Yes. So I would say a few things. First of all, I haven't taken a position on Prop 54.
Come on, let's do it right now.
You want me to go? You want me to go?
God, so close.
I know you were. You were very close. I haven't taken a position on Prop 54 as the sort of chief administrator of the assembly. I understand the dynamics of sort of carrying out some of what the proposition calls for and how incredibly expensive it would be to our institution. That being said, I talk about it all the time. I come from a district. I have 9 cities in my district. 5 of those cities have former council members in prison. So when Ken talks about me going out and doing 18 public hearings throughout the state on the water bond, it was because everything that happens in my office, it's all about accountability. It's all about transparency. With respect to this specific proposition and the quote-unquote cooling off period, I mean, it's a tricky question. Earlier you were talking about money and politics and the influence of money in politics. A lot of folks have wondered whether the 3-day cooling off period would give moneyed interests and those interests who can afford to hire a whole heck of a lot of lobbyists, if it would give them time to sort of scramble the jets and cut down and have certain pieces of legislation voted down. The most obvious example that I can think of right now, because it's fresh in my memory, was SB 32, which is the climate change piece of legislation that we just passed. There were not a lot of moneyed interests wanting us to pass SB 32. There were a lot of moneyed interests wanting us to not pass SB 32. The number of votes that bill got last year versus this year virtually doubled. We took the vote up without a whole heck of a lot of warning. The oil companies did not know when we were taking the bill up. We took it up rather suddenly. I think I knew, and maybe 2 or 3 other people in our house knew. I think that was strategically important to making sure that piece of legislation passed.
Can I jump in? But does that show the ability then to use other tools at your disposal, like when the bill actually is brought up for a vote, rather than drafting of language that hits the floor before the ink is dry, you know, without reference to file, and nobody knows, including the press, may I just say. So we have no ability to tell the public what you're voting on because we haven't seen the language either. I mean, so you have other tools other than writing language quickly and putting it up for a vote. You just said it.
Sure, we do. And that being said, those are also called into question as well with respect to transparency. So, I mean, it's something that cuts, I don't want to say both ways, I would say multiple ways, as does everything in the legislative process. It all turns out being quite complicated.
And I was just going to say, I understand the value of transparency. I try to avoid gutting them in late in the session. But I can assure you, as an observer of the system for a long time, people will game it. And there will be people who work very hard to somehow get language that people do not realize how bad it is in that last version of the bill before the 3-day deadline. So then they can put the spotlight on that and try to blow things up to raise a question of whether something that people felt was desirable may have an unintended consequence that they should stall it out. So I understand the mind of advocates, and I just think we will get a different type of mischief making. I definitely, as I say, democracy is the worst form of government except all the others, but I think it has an ability to try to find a solution. I'm all for not abusing the conference committee process. I actually favor conference committees, using those more to work out some of these things. There's tools in the toolkit that I would personally favor for a strong institution. But I actually think there's probably sort of some optimism associated with Prop 54, and there'll be ways in which people will game that and try to shut down conversations now you can't amend it. So it's up or down on this thing, which you agree is a bad bill because of this language.
So I know this is your chance for some of you in the audience. If you've got some questions, you'll need to raise your hand. We've got a microphone. Look, there's the microphone. It'll come rapidly to you. I'm getting a point. Apparently, I don't have my glasses on. Was there a question over here? Oh, and there's a second microphone. So don't be shy. There's a young lady right here. Let's roll on to this side of the questions. You sure you don't want to take position on 54? Sorry. Go ahead. Go ahead. Sorry.
Hi, my name's Caitlin Maple. How are you doing? So I wanted to go back to this money and politics issue. I work in the political reform space for an organization called California Forward. You might be familiar. And so I hear, in fact, on both sides of the aisle, I hear all the time that no doubt money in politics is an issue. I think that's what you said, Speaker Rendon. So with that acknowledgement and this understanding that there is an issue with IEs and all this jazz, so what is the path forward? Do we have any viable solutions, and are we looking at what those are?
No big deal.
Yeah. Folks in our house, in our caucus, have certainly talked about various ways of dealing with it. Obviously, you run into free speech issues, as we've seen certainly at the federal level. As John was talking about earlier, you have other issues, even you have issues relating to independent expenditures, which are things we can't control. Ken talked earlier about Prop 54. You just wonder about the extent to which people would find ways around good legislation intended to take the money out of politics, which to an extent independent expenditures I think are, or at least have manifested themselves in that realm. There are some of my colleagues talking about it, but again, it's exceptionally complicated in terms of drafting and formulating, but then the carrying out of it as well, I think, would be exceptionally tough too. And I think, since we were talking earlier how the idea for this series developed out of the fact that I'm an Anglophile and watch these Parliament meetings on YouTube all night when I can't sleep. Maybe part of the answer is sort of having a limited elections season. Limited election cycle, campaigning system as they have as well, but something where there's more than just money reform or financial reform.
What about a fundraising blackout, which the lower house never adopted, the upper house did, and then the upper house got rid of it?
It's true. The Senate did have that. The Senate. What was interesting about that was the Senate had that had the fundraising blackout in response to a few problems, ethical problems that happened in their house, none of which had anything to do at all with fundraising. None of it did. So I never quite understood the link, but.
I'm looking for news always. Question right over here. He's a bomb thrower, so that could be trouble. They'll get you the microphone in just a second.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, Assemblyman Mercouli, and John. Great discussion. Question about how maybe external political influences might come down to the ticket in November for us. And we've had a Democratic supermajority in the state before. Do you think your calculus on your responsibilities as legislators or speaker changes if you do come into an arena again where we might face a two-thirds supermajority of one party? Does it change your thought process at all?
I'm sorry, can you repeat the question?
Tristan? Sure. If you wake up in December and find that you'll have a two-thirds supermajority of Democrats.
That's when the votes will stop being counted in December, right?
Does that change your internal calculations at all, when just how you want to manage the House, how maybe a moderate member might want to bring more moderation to the House, et cetera? Does that change anything for you?
I don't think it does overall, in terms of sort of looking at the year, in terms of looking at the year as a whole, it doesn't. I think on any individual vote, it may. I do think that, Ken and I were both here in 2012, our freshman year. We had 55 members there then. Last year, we had 52 members. In terms of driving a pro-democratic agenda, in terms of driving a progressive agenda, we were immeasurably more successful when we were at 52 than we were at 55. Why? I don't know. There are a lot of factors unrelated to the size of our caucus, things out there that happen, things that happen with respect to the presidential, things that happen with respect to the economy, things that happen just sort of individually with members. Also, having a large class, our class of 2012, having us be there for 3 years, that changes our behavior as well. So it's really difficult to predict how any one legislative year is going to develop, but I do think that we can't use the number of seats that we'll have as absolutely certain we can't use the number of seats as a predictor.
And my quick reaction to that would be simply by virtue of the fact that we are getting things done, passing budgets, thinking through policy issues, moving forward, that there's a part of me that feels that your California state legislature is the most important democratic institution on the planet. Too much gridlock in D.C., inability to work through issues, reach consensus, and move forward. So I sort of think whatever the numbers are, if we have the ability to across the aisle, kind of bring more people to the table and try to figure out, okay, maybe the Democrats have the votes to put up a solution to X, but if we tweak X in this and this and this way, it'll have a little more appeal to the folks of Jefferson, California, and our Republican colleagues are counseling us that it would help to do that. Maybe we start doing some of that so that we actually are not just moving our state forward, but we're modeling what a deliberative democracy is all about. I sort of feel that is what we here in California are on the cusp of. We have that potential. And I just think we need to open the conversation among all the members with respect. It still doesn't mean we won't fight on issues, but it can change the tone of the conversation, and we may find a way, like as on the water bond.
I know there are a couple of questions right over here. Ma'am, I saw your hand. She was right before you, so it'd be your seatmate and then you. So 1-2 punch. You could just hand her the mic afterwards.
Thanks. Kara Korches. And I actually represent optometrists, so thanks for mentioning us. Sometimes people forget about the eye guys, but I'm not here today.
I don't, because I left my glasses at home.
Well, I could recommend a good optometrist for you. I'm not here today, though, on behalf of optometry. I'm here as a graduate student at Sac State in public policy. And the whole reason we're here today is the intersection of politics and academics. So just a question for both of the assembly members up here. How are you taking any steps, or is it a priority of the assembly to make sure we are formulating policy rooted in data? I know we have a lot of great PhDs in the room that do a lot of great research, unbiased. Are you taking any steps to make sure some of the statutes and the bills that are being talked about are rooted in data?
I was always a complicated academic. I have a PhD, but it's in political philosophy, so all the data people never liked me. They said you just sit around reading Aristotle all day, to which I would say yeah. but no, absolutely. I mean, I think one of the things that's interesting about this giant state of 38.5 million people is that I come from a very urban environment. My district is urban. I grew up in an urban environment. And I come to Sacramento and I'm voting on agricultural policy, ranching policy, mining issues, things that I have no personal experience with at all. What's interesting, and in that context, you have to be data driven. All of the work that we did on the water bond, all of the hearings that we had on the water bond, always had either some sort of university presence or some sort of think tank presence. I think you're really swinging in the dark if you're not data driven.
And I don't think you can engage in the sort of outreach as on the water bond, actually get out in the public realm and convene hearings. If you're not factually grounded, you're going to hear. So I think the initiative that Mr. Speaker's been leading in terms of getting people out, we're doing it on transportation, we're doing it on other issues. The very fact that we are holding these lectures, Anthony's vision to get us out on college campuses and engage in a conversation, this is like the leading edge of reconnecting the legislature with important public institutions. This is an exciting time to be in the legislature, to to be engaged in a conversation about the future of the state of California and to be working on it, which is the privilege of public office. All of you here should want to run in some realm for public office to work on the future where you're at and just keep climbing that ladder.
Can I say one more thing? I do think that one of the things that I've been frustrated with both when I was in academia and in politics is there's often an anti-intellectual bent or prejudice in our country that exists, and I've seen it just as profoundly on the left and the right. And I think what makes our state so special and unique, and you really see the way economic development occurs in our state around you. I can think of the biotech hub in La Jolla. Why is it there? Because UC San Diego is there. Why did Silicon Valley grow in where it grew? Because Stanford and the universities around that area. I mean, I really believe that our universities are our greatest asset in this state, certainly. And I really believe that if we're not utilizing our intellectual resources in this state, then we're really not going to progress at all.
And ma'am, to the question right beside.
Thank you. Actually, Mr. Myers, you stole my question on transparency.
Oh, sorry.
But I'll just ask another one that I hope is not too far off topic, but it might fit under the legislature's job of oversight. And that is the drug and alcohol and mental health is an epidemic in our state and in the country. And here in California, I'm really concerned that there is no there's no license for drug and alcohol counselors. And with the Affordable Care Act in place, insurance companies are now supposed to cover addiction and mental illness as part of behavioral health. And there's a real lack of a competent, well-trained workforce because there's no licensing requirement and there's no uniform standards for certification of drug and alcohol counselors. This is a long-standing issue in the legislature because governor doesn't want to create a new board, new commissions. I'm sure you're familiar with that.
I know there's a question coming. Sorry, but go
and
ahead.
So the question is, because of that barrier, new boards and commissions that he doesn't want to create, do you have any other, Speaker, do you have any other ideas for how legislation might solve this problem for a well-qualified workforce?
Very good question. The governor not only does not want to create new boards and commissions, but eliminated a whole heck of a lot of them a couple of years ago. I do think your question kind of complements your seatmate's question in that that's the type of issue that could be dealt with in a very data-driven manner, and also in terms of comparatively as well to look at other states or other countries that have dealt with that issue. So, I mean, I'll be 1,000% honest with you. I'm not well versed in that issue, but it sounds like something that we could certainly have somebody do a study on, and that would provide us with some of the data that we would need to address.
Kind of an oversight thing, too, in a way, in terms of whether or not the executive branch is effectively working.
Yeah. I think a way to finesse it, just to... In my city of Rancho Cordova, we developed code enforcement as sort of a specialty to help us improve what had been a very declining community. And we got very active with the code enforcement organization around the state, and based upon the Rancho Cordova experience, they started developing recommended training practices. If you're going to be a code enforcement officer working in local government, trying to help a community improve its character, what sort of training is essential? And we actually got a bill to the governor this year to set some standards that are optional standards, but recommended standards for code enforcement training, and he signed it. So it wasn't a new agency, but it's trying to create sort of a yardstick for what is competency and metric and get people lined up and saying, yes, this is highly commendable, and if you have this sort of certification, that ought to make you more competitive for a job in a city around California. So there are some ways to go about it. But I think you're right. I use that example of laws are on the books. Are the laws being implemented the right ones today? Another way to look at it would be try to find an allied field where maybe there's a lot of emphasis put, but frankly, today it seems like it's a lower priority. So maybe you start making a shift of the shift of resources argument, that to keep our law vital and alive and focused on contemporary needs, there ought to be a reallocation of resources. And so maybe that's another way to frame it for a governor.
Let me get that one back there, and then yours, and we may be running out of time at that point, but go ahead, sir, you can shoot one.
Hi, thank you guys for a fantastic talk. My name is Devin Lavelle. I'm a graduate of the MPPA program here, a former president of the Hornets Policy and Politics Alumni, and a researcher at the California Research Bureau, if you ever need any help with getting a little more data and research into your policies. So my question is, most of the reforms that have happened over the years with between the professionalization of the legislature in the 60s, Prop 13 in the 70s, term limits in the 90s, went through on kind of a reactionary basis. There was something that happened that people were upset about, so they wanted to make a big change. In my observation, that doesn't generally lead to the most well-developed policies.
Roll me a question, because we're tight on time.
Here it is. So looking forward into, 40, 50 years from now, over the things that the legislature is going to be dealing with over that period, what should we be looking at proactively to solve those problems ahead of time?
I hate to keep harkening back to the same reference, but I think a way of ensuring that we're not reacting to whatever particular impetus, to make sure that we're being thoughtful, is to make sure we have data-driven solutions, or that the problems that exist are problems that exist in reality rather than are figments of someone's imagination. I think often when we're reacting, whether it's Prop 13 or term limits, I think we discover after the fact that we've made a tremendous mistake. And I think in order to sort of game things out using data, I think is the best way to avoid that.
Yeah, if you have anything quick, Mr. Cooley, or you?
No, I think that's an outstanding.
Okay. I have gotten the shepherd's crook. I am so sorry. I said I'd have one more question, but I got yanked her. But maybe if either of you could answer her question afterwards, I would love to get it done. It's just I know that we're... if it's like...
In 2018, it's 100 years of women in the
Okay. See if we can find a way to wrap that into things. I've given you a big one there because it's an important topic, and I'm not diminishing it. I'm just mindful of the clock, and I get kicked off the stage. Well, I want to have each of you to have a quick concluding thought. But is there something even in the briefest of lightning rounds that you wanted to say in response to that?
With response to that, absolutely. We being the Democratic Caucus, we have six target candidates this year that we're focusing all of our resources on. Five of the six are women this year, which for me is important in terms of starting to make sure that we're reversing some of the numbers that you talked about, that our caucus is starting to look more like the state that we represent. With respect to what impact women have had on legislation, I decided to run for political office when I was working for an early childhood education organization. And during the Schwarzenegger era, $1.2 billion was eliminated from early childhood education. I was running early childhood education programs. I knew I was having a profound impact on families. I knew I was helping to break the poverty cycle. The Schwarzenegger administration, with help from the legislature, eliminated $1.2 billion in funding for early childhood education. This year, in a single year, we put $600 million into early childhood education in our budget in California. That was pushed by the Women's Caucus. It was pushed by Christina Garcia on our side, Hannah Beth Jackson, On the Senate side, that was a priority of the Women's Caucus, and we did it, and it was driven by the Women's Caucus.
So let me, a few quick concluding thoughts here. Mr. Cooley, we're going to say this is your home field. You have home field advantage. You can offer a couple of quick thoughts, and then Speaker Rendon will wrap up.
Well, I just
microphone, if you can grab it.
Forgot the other one was taken. This is where we work on the future. The legislature is where we work on the future. You've heard me say that over and over. And it's something that don't wait for someone to throw you the opportunity to serve. Seek the opportunity to serve. It is a tremendous thing. I have hanging on the wall of my office a Christmas card that crossed my desk, my first Christmas in the building in 1977, because of the quote that's on it. It's a quote by a guy named John Wesley. Hillary Clinton used it at the night she accepted the nomination. Do all the good you can, do all the people you can, and all the times you can, and all the places you can, in all the ways you can, as long as you ever can. This, to me, this notion of serving people in any and all ways, with all your power, your entire life, is what public service offers. I will quote Rabindranath Tagore, who is a Bengali poet, who received the Nobel Prize for Literature in 1913, who said, "I slept and dreamt that life was joy. I awoke and saw that life was service. I acted, and behold, service was joy." I just want to commend to you, take this conversation to heart, look for a way to serve in your community, and to be a part of changing the future of this state, because I assure you, we change things here, we will change our country. In positive ways, we will change the globe. And it starts with you raising your hand and not being put off by money, power, prospects. Just make a difference where you are and let people notice you.
Mr. Speaker, last
thank
word.
Well, first I want to thank Mr. Myers, Mr. Cooley for their participation, and obviously to the university and the students for being here. All models of participatory democracy are good models. What we've been trying to do as a class since Kit Ken and I got to the Assembly in 2012 is to make sure that we have more models of formal participatory democracy, but also the way we just sort of, the way we act, the way we sort of orient ourselves in office. Ken goes to coffee shops in his district, and he puts up a laptop that has a bumper sticker, his own bumper sticker on the outside, so everybody knows who he is. And these are sort of open office hours, so you can come up and ask Ken Cooley questions about California politics, about what's happening in the district. We have government 101s in my district, where we talk to people about the different responsibilities of government. This is part of that as well. This sort of participatory democracy, being here today is a big part of that. Ken talked about involvement. There's no surprise that there's no mystery as to why we had this here today. This is a university, this is a system that's obviously very important to us, but a campus that's even more important to us because of its proximity to the campus, to the Capitol. So to the extent that you can become more involved, either through internships, through fellowships, through coming down and watching a committee hearing and find out what we're doing, that's better for you and it's better for us. It's really what we want our institution to be. I was running a nonprofit organization 4 years ago. I never ran for office in my life. Now I'm serving in this great institution with Kevin and with Ken. The changes that can happen in this state because of institutions, because of low-cost, high-quality public institutions like Sac State, can really change. They can change your life, and they can change our state. And we've been doing that collectively. This institution has been doing that collectively, and I hope this afternoon has been part of that as well.
And I get to say what I never get to say. We're adjourned. Anyway, no, thank you very much.
Just make three very quick comments. One is really want to thank John Myers and Speaker Mr. Cooley for their time today. It's just been a great conversation. Number two, note that I wasn't able to make the announcement earlier when we got started, but Assemblymember Kevin McCarty is here, and he's a alum of our Master's in Public Policy Administration program. And number three, I want to invite all of you to walk just down the hall to the patio there at Roundtable, where we'll have a reception and we'll be able to continue the conversation. So thanks again for coming.